speechless. And the king said to the attendants, "Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen." The Gospel of the Lord. Would you be seated? I don't think it's possible this morning to begin a reflection on a gospel about the coming of the kingdom of God without acknowledging the intense suffering and terrible tragedy presently at this moment afflicted on God's own people, the people of Israel, and the Palestinian people who have long shared that land. We can only think of the suffering on both sides. The young Israeli people happily attending a music festival, and then the women and children brutally killed in Palestinian cities a little later. What an intense grief and sadness that all of this blood being spilt on both sides, on the very roads, the walkways, the trails walked by Jesus himself. The true values of the Bible, the Quran, and the Gospels have no part in this suffering. When Jesus looked down over his beloved Jerusalem, he wept for the coming suffering that he knew would destroy his city. He wept for all humankind and for all who fall to violence and war in the world. And I don't really know what it means, but I believe that Jesus weeps again this morning as he looks over Israel and Gaza. We also must weep for innocent lives lost, for human rights trod upon by both sides, for ideologies born in blood and greed so long ago, for hostages and their families held unjustly, of course, as pawns in a game they never joined. And we also need to remember those groups, those people who continue to work and be willing to die to encourage peace. That terribly elusive word. We must pray also for political and military leaders on both sides, that the voices of terrorized children suffering may reach up to them, to their ears, to their hearts, the core of their hearts. And we might say, Amen. Wouldn't it have been wonderful to have been with Jesus as he walked his roads, walking with him and beginning to understand more and more how his concept of the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, developed. It wasn't right at the very beginning. It seems like it grew unfolded to him, what his role in it was. How did Jesus see his mission on earth? Well, so involved with this whole kingdom of God, kingdom of God. To have been with him, well, that's a little bit naive, isn't it, right now? Real life, think about it, real life, our lives plod along from one event to another. Often with no time seemingly to reflect at all and maybe grow from it. Being there with Jesus, one would have had to have been there, to experience what they experienced, his followers. One argument with each other, who was going to be the greatest? Can my relative sit up here with me? One village to go to, one run-in with the Pharisees. You know, all the pressures of daily life. They had to think about food. They had to think about shelter. They had to think about safety. They had to think about tiredness. And, you know, maybe those things took priority most of the time. The Gospels show that the apostles, those closest to Jesus, his friends, didn't have any real idea what he meant by the kingdom of God. As I said, they just constantly misunderstood him. Well, if we had been there with him, would we have recognized him? Well, it might be easy to say, oh yes, but would we actually have listened to him enough to say, yes, I'll follow your call, I'll give up everything, I'm here? Who knows? You know, most of the sincere, good-living Jews of his time saw him really as more of a curiosity than anything else. And others rejected him as being too liberal, you know, cherry-picking laws to fit in with what he wanted to say. Well, who can tell in that place where we would have been? But then again, maybe day by day, walking with him, watching him heal, watching him touch, listening to him speak, maybe we'd have been different. Who knows? But the truth is, we are born when we are born, and we face the challenges, the doubts, the worries, the fears of our time. You know, just a little aside, at the 8 o'clock Eucharist at the end, that all came to me when a young man came in needing someone to talk to, utterly overwhelmed by fear, tiredness, being scared for the future and for this moment. He was a weary young man, and kind of scary too, what he was thinking. So we here this morning have the help of 2,000 years, 2,000 years of reflection, scripture study, major scripture study, and spirituality to help us to see what he meant by the kingdom of God. We have that advantage. But we also have the disadvantage of being 2,000 years removed from him, removed from his life. Where his followers faced persecution for following him, you know, if someone says that to us today, we're going to probably regard it as quite irrelevant to our lives because they accuse us of following Jesus. But I think we can't get away from the fact of looking at those gospel values of the kingdom of heaven, comparing them with the values of this world, of our world, this moment, right here. Does anyone truly believe it was any easier then? Truly believe it is any easier today? Probably not. They're both rough, hard stuff. The past several weeks in the lectionary, the common lectionary, we have had parables, and they've been difficult. They've been strange. He spoke of a God, remember? He spoke of a God whose generosity is beyond anything we can imagine. Doesn't compare with our sense of generosity, but God's generosity beyond anything we can imagine. And he told us not to be shocked by it. God just doesn't seem to do it our way. He spoke of a kingdom which is for everyone, no exceptions, no walls to keep people out. God's kingdom is for all who gently, humbly, and sincerely work for it. And then now, right now, we've just learned that we must not take the kingdom of God for granted. We must, expression that she used, dress up for it, huh? Dress up for it, treat it as important, treat it with awe and wonder that kingdom of God deserves, not to take it lightly, not to take it for granted. And the invitation to join is just as real and urgent today as when the fishermen left their nets to follow. It's just as real today as it was then. Different, but just as real and just as true and just as frightening. Jesus and his followers lived in their time. We live in our time, and we face our time and our times. They had theirs, we have ours, and together we make thy kingdom come. Jesus gave many guidelines to the kingdom, what to do, and also what not to do. Two weeks ago, I remember standing here and saying the same words as Jesus was with and for his friends, his followers after his disciples. So he is with us. Somehow, we have to hold on. No, we don't have to do anything. Somehow, we need to hold on to he is with us. Wonderful ways. And we, you, the faithful followers after, make your way here each Sunday, an effort, but you make your way here in faithfulness to what he did, not different, but what he did. How do we do that? Well, in the gospel, the word of God, in the praying, in the prayers, and in that greatest of gifts, the Holy Eucharist. and with each other. We are not alone. With others with whom we walk in the pathways of our world together. All are invited to be a part of God's kingdom, everyone. All are invited to that great wedding feast. And that great wedding feast is the kingdom of God. It can sound overwhelming. And it is, and it isn't. We live our lives in this place, at this time, in this particular and peculiar community of great wealth and education, with our own challenges because of it. It can be in the smallest of ways that we bring the kingdom of God to our world. You know, I often say at funerals that we all live with our hierarchy of false gods. I'm not going to name what mine are or ask you to name yours, but we all know what they are, what the false gods of living in such entitlement. And amidst all of that, the smallest gesture, the smallest thing can be an inbreaking of the kingdom of God. When your friend, your acquaintance, is troubled, is frightened, is beyond him or herself, and our words really don't help, words usually don't help, and we usually can't make people's deep problems go away. But the tiny thing of simply going to someone and putting your hand on their arm and some of the strength that you have at this moment, some of the courage you have at this moment can flow out from you into that other hurting human being. And you would have been Jesus for that person. And you had brought the kingdom of God to that person. We're very special. We're very special. Let us turn now in prayer to God, in the holy name of Jesus, shepherd of the sheep, and our great high priest.
By your glorious ascension, you have extended your body to all flesh, birthing a new human family from the cradle, cross, and crown. Give us grace to embody this new life of service and sacrifice, following the good example of your saints, that in the fullness of time we might obtain your promises with all who have gone before and all who will come after. Jesus, our brother, head of the church, hear us, we pray. By your righteous rebuke, you made a mockery of the self-appointed powers of the age, of their petty disputes and sweeping injustices. Set our hearts aright once more in this and every land, where arrogance turns to conflict, where conflict turns to violence, and where violence turns to war. Remembering this morning, especially Ukraine, Palestine, Israel, and so many other places around this globe of ours. Hasten the day when all the peoples of the earth will be united under your most gracious rule. Jesus, our judge, Christ the King, hear us, we pray. By your wise teachings, you called us to emulate the effortless grace of creation in the lilies of the field and the birds of the air. But instead, our ceaseless striving has depleted and denatured the earth, threatening upheaval around the world. We pray this morning for all those affected by weather and climate disasters, especially in our continent, in the South Pacific, in every other continent, making up our entire world. Jesus, our Word, Lord of the Sabbath, hear us, we pray. By your liberating life, you proclaimed release for the captives, recovery of sight for the blind, and freedom for the oppressed. We give thanks today for the jail ministry and all who work for criminal justice reform in this land. Jesus, our good news, anointed one of God, hear us, we pray. By your compassionate ministry, you restored those who were brokenhearted and broken in body. Speak a word of life over those we bear to you this day on our prayers, especially Linda, John, Corey and family, the Wilkin Gaines family, Alan, Ted, Paula, Sally, Ogden, Monique, Willem, James, Elizabeth, Juliet, and Mary Jo. May they know the power of your Spirit in the midst of suffering and adversity. Jesus, our hope, healer of the sick, hear us, we pray. By your resurrection from the dead, you opened the way for us to eternal life. Welcome into your everlasting arms, Jim Newton, and give us a share with them in that most heavenly home where you feast forever with all the saints in light. Jesus, our way, our truth, and our life, hear us, we pray.
One with your saints in heaven and on earth. Grant that in our earthly pilgrimage, we may be always supported by this fellowship of love and prayer, and to know ourselves to be surrounded by their witness to your power and mercy. We ask this for the sake of Jesus Christ, in whom all our intercessions are acceptable through the Spirit, and who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Okay. May the peace of the Lord be always with you. Well, it seems one very nice lady has something she wishes to share.
If you look on the last page of the bulletin, you'll see there's a sentence that says, "Today's flowers on the altar were created by our Owls Commission for the congregation with God's love and blessing." The Owls may just have to take a trip to the Chelsea Flower Show now that we've learned the art of spectacular from our Friday speaker, Carmen Pecklesma. After we saw Carmen create her arrangement for us, a group of Owls and their lunch guests helped put together the second altar vase. It turned into an example of a beautiful and very ecumenical time together. In the group of women guests joining our Owls to create the second arrangement was a diocesan representative from St. Mark's, a Presbyterian, a friend from First Congregational Church, a Christian Scientist, and a Jewish friend visiting Trinity for the very first time. It was a wonderful opportunity for people to work together in the spirit of new friendship and cooperation. So when you look at these, can you tell which arrangement is the Owls and which is Carmen, the professionals? Well, no hints are going to be given. After the service, we'll bring the two arrangements out to the courtyard for you to take a bouquet, a small bouquet, home with you to enjoy for this week. So thank you.
Thank you. They are very lovely, very lovely. Thank you. And now as we prepare to come to our Lord's table, remember what he said, it's more blessed to give than to receive. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, that through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, that through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine, the work of human hands, to become for us the blood of Christ. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to God. It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of all life and fountain of mercy. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we fail to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us, and so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up the prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then, in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word, made mortal flesh in Jesus. Born into the human family and dwelling among us, he revealed your glory. Giving himself to death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died for us, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and he gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant, which is poured out for you in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts will be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, that with all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be all honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
Now, as Jesus prayed for the coming of the kingdom, so do we. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ was born, lived, died, and was raised for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Follow in the Gospels would never turn away anyone from his table. Come if you so wish.
Thank you.
Now in thanksgiving, let us pray. O God, the Creator, O Christ, the incarnate Word, O Holy Spirit, the giver of life, O blessed Trinity of love, you have fed us with your grace, in the foretaste of your heavenly banquet. We commit to walk in the way of Jesus.
Send us forth bearing your justice and mercy,
to transform the world with your love in our hearts, your truth in our minds, your strength in our wills, until at the end of our journey, we know the joy of our homecoming
and the welcome of your embrace. In Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
I simply have to say this morning that the music this morning was so beautiful, that the rudder was just very beautiful. Thank you very much, those who gave us that great gift. Very beautiful. The Spirit of God fill you with all power and blessing. The Spirit of God unite the church in love and gather us together in her harvest of justice. The Spirit of God bring us to that table which she spreads in the presence of Christ and feasts forever with all the saints in light. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Now let us go out into the world to love, to serve the Lord in one another. Alleluia, alleluia.